salvage the last possession of the half. They put three on the board in the Stanford run, and it's a two-touchdown game. Let's head to John Saunders and Terry Bowden, Times Square Stadium in New York.
You see the story in Tucson, a big second quarter for Stanford and a 14-point halftime lead. Arizona needed a 52-yard field goal just to get within 14. Sean Grandy, Reggie Rivers here at the half. Glad to have you with us on this Saturday night from Tucson. This game, Reggie, I don't think it could have gone more according to form. We talked about time of possession, about third down conversions for Stanford, and that's exactly what we've seen here. They have run the ball a lot, they have kept the ball a lot, and they put Arizona behind the eight ball.
They have completely controlled the clock in this one, which has been their pattern throughout the season. I'm surprised that Arizona hasn't countered with their running game. With Clarence, their running back there, Clarence Farmer, he is a guy they could give the ball to him, run the ball a lot, establish some ground game, eat up some of the clock, but they really haven't taken advantage of that at all so far.
He has only run the ball five times in the first half, which is a very, very small number. You would certainly not expect to see Arizona, a 50-50 running passing team, and yet they have thrown the ball two out of every three plays, and that has pretty much been the plan. Rick Dyke's apparently seeing something that has enabled him to put his quarterback, Jason Johnson, back in the shotgun. Throughout most of the first half, now Arizona will want to throw the ball because they trail by two touchdowns as we get set to begin the second half. That's Andre Thurman and Gary Love back to receive the kick. It'll be Love. And again, he will drop the knee. Mike Pacelli, a couple of field goals in this game, and that is the fourth touchback on kickoff. So we haven't even had a chance to see the Arizona kick return game. Our Morgan Stanley, well-connected storyline. Well, I'll tell you what, sometimes you get lucky when you plan these games ahead of time and you start doing your research, you notice, hey, you know, Arizona's last in the Pac-10 in time possession, Stanford is first. You don't expect things to always work out that way, but it's exactly what we've seen, and here's the point I want to make. Look at the yards per play. Arizona and Stanford have very similar numbers this year, and yet the yards per play favor Arizona.
They favor Arizona, but what Arizona's not doing is holding onto the ball. So when you have about the same average per play, but the other team holds on to the ball so much longer than you do, they're going to rack up more yards.
And they're going to throw on the first play of the second half. It's Wade. He has the ball knocked away. It's picked out of the air by Tank Williams. Touchdown, Stanford. Unbelievable.
Now, you talk about a game going to form. With Stanford, everything's going right for Stanford, everything going wrong for Arizona. You watch him on the outside, Bobby Wade gets the ball, fights off the first blocker, it's the second one, or first tackler, second one, and Tank Williams catches it in midair, takes it in for the touchdown. So right off the bat, now it's a 20-point game, about to be 21.
The Wildcats trying to get something started on the first play of the second half, are run over by a Tank. 33-13. It was Matt Fredericks, the middle linebacker, who popped the ball free. Did you say earlier that tip balls, deflected balls, balls in the air don't favor the offense? It's the worst case scenario, and Jason Johnson now knows it.
A tip ball is the enemy of the offense, and nothing good ever happens when a ball gets in the air like that.
The loss for John Makovic here is the sixth loss of the year, which makes them not bowl eligible.
And we talked to him about being a first-year coach here. And, you know, you come in, you don't know exactly what you have. You're dealing with players that were brought in by your predecessor, but you hope that you can do some good things. Now he comes in thinking, well, if we can get to a bowl game the first year, that's not bad. Even finishing 5-6 is not terrible for the first year.
John Makovic told us yesterday that everybody always says, hey, you got a great team here. If you had only been here last year, we would have won a bunch of more games. Every first-year coach knows that speech, but you just don't really know until you see your players on the field. In college football, the recruiting cycle is 5 years. It takes a long time to get your own players on the field.
And they did start this season 3-0, so there was a certain truth to that idea that, hey, you had some good guys here to work with, but then the wheels kind of fell off as soon as they hit conference play.
They beat San Diego State, Idaho, and UNLV, but then lost five in a row in the Pac-10, and they finished with five straight losses in the Pac-10 last year. Maselli adds the extra point. Arizona does all that work to get within field goal range and hit a 52-yarder to get within two touchdowns. Then on the opening play of the third quarter, a freak fumble in the air and a touchdown return by Tank Williams puts Stanford up by 21. And you want to talk about the perfect scenario playing on the road to have that happen on the first play of the second half when the crowd was just getting back into it. Life goes on in a halftime speech. Only to have that happen on the first play. Gary Love, again, will drop the knee for the fifth time in this one.
I don't know, Ty Willingham might have, during his halftime speech, have said, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to come out, we're going to cause a fumble to pop up in the air, we're going to catch it, run it in for a score to ice this game. That might have been his speech. Now, as crazy as this sounds, I think Arizona needs to come out and now establish their running game. If nothing else, they need to keep Stanford's offense off the field, but they have Clarence Farmer back there. Give him the ball, start to establish a running game. Yeah, they've got a lot of ground to make up, but they've got a half to do it in.
They've got a lot of plays, the way they've been throwing it on every down. Melosi Leonard hadn't even turned yet, hadn't even finished his curl, and that ball had already hit the ground.
Even though you're down by 21 points and you think, oh my gosh, that means we have to pass the ball, I think this is one of those situations. You're down by 21 and you've got an entire half to play. You look at the numbers comparing Jason Johnson to Chris Lewis. You know, Jason Johnson's completed about 50% of his passes for 193 yards. He's got more yards than Chris Lewis, but obviously not as many points.
Farmer, a rare carry in this one, tries to get to the outside, salvages a couple of yards after the end of the run, but that's just the sixth carry for Clarence Farmer, the player that we not only figured would be the key to this game today, Stanford figured he would be the key to this game today, and he has not been a factor because he hasn't gotten the ball.
And when we met with Coach Makovich yesterday, we said, what do you need to do offensively to win this thing? The first thing out of his mouth was, Clarence Farmer has to get 100 to 150 yards. I said, well, how many carries do you think he's going to get to do that? He said 20. He's going to have to break some big ones. But so far, he's only had six carries in the game.
Yeah, in the first half, very low number. Johnson throws over the middle complete as Anthony Fulcher. He escapes to the outside. Fulcher trying to get the sideline is pushed out of bounds past the 40-yard line. It's Colin Branch on the saving tackle. We told you Arizona doesn't like to throw to their backs, but this man, Anthony Fulcher, is the exception to that rule, his ninth catch of the year. Well, first down, maybe this will be something to get Arizona kick-started. Johnson's had time tonight, as you would expect he would. Again, they go back to Fulcher on the right side. Another great move to cut back, and he has another Arizona first down. Four wide receivers for Arizona.
The blitz is coming.
They're showing, they're coming. Johnson gets rid of it just as well. Johnson, a couple of touchdown catches, a couple of big third down catches as well. As Stanford built the big lead. Johnson's had nothing if not time. Throwing deep, Thurman.
But they have two backs on the field, probably, and the only reason they have two backs on the field is to protect against the blitz, so they have somebody back there to block.
Another third and long. Johnson, incomplete. Looking out for Brandon Marshall, and now you got another dicey situation here. Keel hit from 52. I don't know if you want to look a gift horse in the mouth here and try another long one. They're going to. You can eat it however you want to eat it. 43-yard attempt. Keel hit from 52 to end the first half. Would have been good from 60. This one looks like it's on the money, and guess what it is? Sean Keel has been the star offensively for Arizona. 52-yard field goal, now a 43-yarder to keep Arizona alive. Three points at a time, Arizona chipping away. Still trail by 18 here, and must figure out a way to get Stanford's offense off the field. See, even Arizona's scoring drive, which was impressive, did not take a lot of time off the clock. Allen, about 4 yards deep, will drop the knee. John, that's going to be a big one for Florida and Washington State as well, with Washington losing today, heading into the Apple Cup. This you'll see next week on ABC Sports. On first down, dropped. Teo Johnson, who's already starring in the highlight reel, dropped it, hearing footsteps from Jermaine Chapman.
It's a rare drop by Teo. He's got very soft hands.
Caught six in the first half for 105 yards, two touchdowns, and two other catches that were third and long.
And every catch that he made was an impressive catch or an impressive run. This kid is just, I mean, at 6'7", 245 pounds, you don't see wide receivers who are that size, and I don't know if the defense knows what to do with him.
He was recruited to Stanford, by the way. He came in as a quarterback on second down. Pitch to Allen. Escapes the first hit. This is not a replay. He's across the 25, out near the 27-yard line. You give him 7 yards on second down. And there's yak yards, yards after the catch. But how about yards after contact of Ryan Allen tonight?
Ryan Allen, every time, and he's got a little shoe problem. He's trying to get the official to stop the clock, but that's not going to happen. But he gets off the field. But this is a guy, he just does things that you don't expect him to do. He gets hit in the backfield, and somehow he ends up 7 yards later, he's down the field. And you look at it, and you say, how did he do that? But play after play after play, he does it.
Getting about 7 yards per carry tonight. Powell goes in motion. That's Justin Faust, who has replaced him as the lone setback, replaced Allen. Complete. Another first down. It's another third down completion. Mateo Johnson. Mateo Johnson comes out. Another first down. Faust. Out to the 35. The big play was made by Stanford's defense. It was the opening play of the second half. Fumble caused by Matt Fredericks. Bobby Wade couldn't hang on to it. Tank Williams picked it out of the air, ran it in for a touchdown, and that made it a 3-touchdown game instead of a 2-touchdown game, which it was at the half. Arizona's come back with a field goal, but right now, Tank Williams has the big play.
And what a way to start off the second half for Stanford, and as Arizona was making progress trying to get back into this.
Complete. Teo Johnson out at the 40. Another. Now he's going to be close to a first down. They may mark him down about a yard short. What an interesting game. Syracuse-Miami a couple of weeks ago looked like it would be an ugly one. Now Miami barely survived in Chestnut Hill, and Syracuse won 7 in a row. Allen hit in the backfield, escapes it, and he's going to be close to a first down. You saw Lance Briggs kicking the dirt in frustration, because it looks like Stanford is going to move the chains again, and they had Allen in the backfield.
That's exactly the matchup you'd want. Lance Briggs coming through, hitting Allen in the backfield, and you hope that your linebacker is going to win that battle. But as we've talked about Brian Allen all day, he has a way to make people miss, get off that first tackle, and still make the first down.
Yet another first down. 17th for Stanford in this game. They'll go five wide on first down. Chris Lewis going to go deep. His receiver was taken down, Ryan Wells. He got his feet tangled. Looks like Lance Briggs was out there in coverage with him. They got their feet tangled. Wells went down.
Now, you see him get tangled up here. He's the inside receiver, and as they start to run by each other, it's not really a tangle up. That's a push. That could have been pass interference, but I guess if the ball wasn't in the air yet. You know, on the top end of the field, Teo Johnson ran right over Kirk Johnson, the linebacker who was covering him, wide open, but the quarterback didn't see him.
On second down, it'll be Allen again. Push, flags are down as Allen turns the corner. He's inside the 35-yard line, but hold the phone.
I think that's going to be a holding. It looked like the left tackle tackled the defensive end on this side of the field.
Ty Willingham has seen this kind of game unfold all year. Lewis throws it away and spikes it in the ground. That was caught. Fans booing, they wanted a grounding call. Let's check out our Pacific Light game summary. This was the first play of the third quarter. Looks like it could be a big game for Bobby Wade, but the ball's knocked away, and here comes Tank Williams out of nowhere to run it back 25 yards, and instead of a 2-touchdown lead, it became a 3-touchdown lead. Safeties don't get to make plays much bigger than that one. That's a great moment in the life of a safety.
That's what you dream about as a safety, and I'm sure Tank will remember that play in this game for a long, long time.
They call it an incompletion, so it is third and 20. They go to Allen, he turns the corner, and not going to be much there this time. Joe Levette comes up to get it.
And we've seen this Arizona team get into difficult situations in some of their games in the past against some very good teams, but hang on, and Allen looks like he's shaken up a little bit. Now, but he's getting up and walking himself off. Looks like his arm or shoulder or something is bothering him. Well, we've seen Arizona against very good teams, against Washington particularly sticks out of my mind, where they start off, Washington comes out, bang, bang, scoring points, but Arizona hangs on, they keep playing, they fight their way back. You know, I don't know that you can rule Arizona out despite the fact they're down 18 points.
Eric Johnson on the punt for just the second time in this game. Bobby Wade back deep. High snap, there's a low one earlier, he's in big trouble. Johnson's going down, Arizona gets the big play on special teams.
Now, you know, punter in this case, the ball is really high on the snap to him. He makes the decision to not kick it. Probably a good decision, that was gonna get blocked, maybe somebody picks it up and runs in, but he holds on and gets tackled.
They never changed the ball.
On first down, Farmer turns the corner. One of his biggest runs of the night. You see that score pop up on your screen, but Arizona was throwing the ball even when this game was a lot closer. Farmer, twice in a row, runs right into Colin Branch, the strong safety. Trying to become the 11th Wildcat to rush for 1,000 yards in the season. Johnson. Complete inside the 10 and down to the 5 goes the tight end Justin Levasseur, first and goal, Arizona. Ware on first and goal. Clarence Farmer was spilled and has no gain. Now 8:10 to go in the third quarter. The college football game is a lifetime. This is why you were saying, Richie, go to Clarence Farmer, do what you do. Just keep this thing close. That is a ton of time. There are a lot of plays left in this game.
If you can score a touchdown here and go for the 2 points, make it 24-34, it's a 10-point game with a quarter and a half to play.
Double tight end on second and goal. Johnson in trouble. That goes nowhere. He puts it on the ground. That's a live football. Coy Wire is not going to be caught. Two monstrous third quarter mistakes made by Arizona. Touchdown, Stanford.
Jason Johnson just trying to make a play on the roll. I mean, this bootleg had no chance, but he tries to throw the ball anyway. Probably should have held on to it and taken the sack, and then the result is disastrous. Coy Wire, who used to be a running back, was Stanford's leading rusher 2 years ago back in 1998. He moved over to linebacker, became their leading tackler, and now he looks like he's back to his running back days. You watch the as he comes out here, you can almost call that an incomplete pass. It's too bad that they don't have instant replay in college, because you could make an argument there for that was an incomplete pass.
Instead of the incompletion, it's an 89-yard fumble return for a touchdown. Baselli adds the extra point. Stanford's two best defensive players, Coy Wire and Tank Williams, have each scored touchdowns in the third quarter. Stanford up big. Like no protest from the Arizona side.
And the thing is, the official was standing off to the side from where we were sitting and from where he was. The impetus of the way that ball came out, it looked like a fumble. Yeah. And unless you...
Reggie Rivers, I'm not sure this was a fumble.
I think this is a forward pass. You watch his arm, watch his right arm. He throws this ball forward. Intentional grounding, you could call, but it's definitely not a fumble. But I think the official was shielded from it and from those views. And Johnson, you watch him when he gets up, he's pleading with the referees. Hey, that was a fumble. I mean, that was an incomplete pass.
Instead, Coy Wire, the only player in Stanford history to lead the team both in tackling and in rushing, rushes 89 yards with the fumble return, and the entire complexion of this game has changed as a result. Coy Wire and Love into the pile, and Arizona will take over first down, but now they've got a mountain to climb. John Rattay, the transfer from Tennessee, is the new Arizona quarterback. He finds Bobby Wade on his first throw for a first down. Bobby Wade has made a bunch of plays already. Talked about wanting to get him 10 touches. He's made 6 catches in this game. Rattay came in last week. Not last week, he came in against Washington. That after Jason Johnson went out with a slight concussion. Played well, kept Arizona in that game a long time. Bertay, quick out, high throw, but it's caught. Velocity Leonard went up high to get that one. Over Lee Torrance.
And with this kind of point deficit, I can understand why you keep throwing the ball. I'm still a big believer in, if you've got your stud running back in the backfield and you're trying to get your offense going, you've got to use your stud running back.
See, Arizona State making it a game. Not done yet. Arizona State next week. On a delay, Stanford still stripping for the football. It's Tremaine Cox. Well, that's a couple of yards. That Arizona State game, I should point that out. That is in 2 weeks. It's their next game, but it's not next week. Arizona would like to play another game tomorrow if they could. Bertay. Juggled and caught by Thurman. Cuts back to the middle of the field. It's Coy Wire who chases him down. So we consider their second best wide receiver and just a sophomore. I think he's going to be a big prospect. He and Bobby Wade are going to make quite a 1-2 tandem next year after Wilson Leonard graduates. Tremaine Cox trying to find a hole up the middle. Now Rattay, the freshman, will change the play at the line of scrimmage. Has to find a hot receiver and sails it over the head of Brandon Marshall. Arizona 4-8 on third down. It's going to be 4-9 as Tremaine Cox comes up short. Arizona 2-7 this year on fourth down.
This is not an easy fourth down distance.
It's in between. Tay will throw to try to keep the possession alive. Goes over the middle, incomplete. Stanford will get it back. Intended for the tight end, Justin Levasseur. Oh, Stanford gets the football back. They will put it behind that big offensive line and try to end John Makovic's day poorly. Didn't go down. He's still on his feet. Live football. Kenneth Tolan across the 40, stumbling at the 30. If he can break free, which he does, they're not going to get him. Another incredible third quarter play for the Stanford Cardinal.
The Cardinal are living a charmed life. Watch Tolan here. He gets spun around. He never touches the ground. He sits down on the defender, gets his hand down. Everybody thinks he's down, but he knows he's not. He takes off running again. And then even beyond that, a great job of running down the field, making people miss, keeping his balance to get it all the way into the end zone. This is a kid the Stanford coaches are very high on, and he shows you a little bit of that ability right there.
This third quarter, they're going to be remembered for a very long time and not fondly by the Arizona Wildcats. Baselli adds the extra point. Three of the most bizarre, game-changing plays you will ever want to see have come within an 11-minute span here in the third quarter and a turn what was a very promising game into a blowout. Here's another look at Tolan never hitting the ground.
I mean, you think about this. First, we have the fumble that pops in the air, then the pass that wasn't a pass, and now the spin that doesn't touch the ground. I mean, just three strange plays. But, you know, Stanford would argue, hey, when you're working hard, strange good things happen for you. And Tolan is able to turn this one into a monster touchdown. Man, this will be on his highlight reel. He's a redshirt freshman, and with the ability that he has, he's going to have a lot of plays on that reel before he's out of here.
And you know, if you're feeling like you're living a charmed life on the farm, Washington loses their game today. Washington State doesn't have it wrapped up yet against Arizona State. Oregon did win their game, but if you're Stanford, as we said, you need Oregon involved somehow in the tie because you won the head-to-head game with Oregon.
So you start off today, you look at Stanford and you say the chances of going to the Fiesta Bowl and winning the...
Just about zero.
Yeah. But now, the way things are turning out, who knows? Stanford can't be ruled out.
Well, Baselli in a familiar position. Here to third quarter. Fourth time he has kicked off. He has put a bunch of them into the end zone tonight, and this one is going to be no exception. Arizona has been living first and 10 from their own 20-yard line, and Stanford has been living a charmed life. Get a load of these two plays by the Stanford defense. This is the first play of the third quarter.
First play of the second quarter, and Bobby Wade trying to make a play. Ball pops into the air. Tank Williams lived every safety's dream, takes it to the end zone. And then Jason Johnson trying to pass it here. I think it's a pass, but the officials don't call it that way. Corey Wire picks it up, and, well, you know, takes him about 10 seconds to run the distance.
Add to that the 71-yard run by Tolan. And that's three monstrous plays by Stanford here in the third quarter to put some big-time distance between themselves and Arizona. Ball very nearly intercepted, intended for Wade. My goodness.
The defense has done just one sack, but they've recovered three fumbles and one interception. And now the defense has scored two touchdowns as well. And, you know, anytime on defense you can score one touchdown, you're having a good day.
That's 22 takeaways now for Stanford. This is their eighth game. Movement everywhere. This goes nowhere.
They had to win this game to give themselves a chance to go to a bowl. They know that they can't do it now. You look at the points that off turnovers. Stanford has had one turnover, and Arizona got 7 points off it. But look at Arizona. 24 points have come on turnovers. You just can't win when you're turning the ball over that way.
Arizona turnover ratio minus 11 in Pac-10 play. Jermaine Cox gets hammered, and now Stanford is just teeing off on defense. They are filled to the brim with confidence, and wouldn't you be?
Of course.
And here is, to me, the biggest question of all. Stanford entered this game with, to suggest they had a patchwork defensive line to start this game might be an understatement. And yet, Arizona never attacked it. They went right to the air for the beginning of the game.
Yeah, they had Marcus Hoover is had their weekend, had a bad ankle. They have Trey Freeman also had a bad ankle. Austin Lee was out because of a knee injury. And the Stanford coaches were very concerned about all the injuries they had, but Arizona didn't come in and really try to attack them on the ground.
Matt Leonard was out as well. They have a player, Drew Kaler, who played offense last week, who started tonight on the defensive line. But John Bate and his predecessor, Jason Johnson, have been unable to get anything done.
And if you don't have a running game, I can understand why you would just pass the ball and say, well, we can't really take advantage of that. But you do have Clarence Farmer creeping up on 1,000 yards this season, who is a great back with everything you'd want out of a back. I would think that you come out in this one and just give it a shot at least to run the ball.
Peru's kick is handled, fair caught by Lou Powell at midfield, and Stanford will get it back. And here's the number. If for some reason Clarence Farmer does not return, and who knows, maybe he won't, this game upon which both Stanford thought and we thought this game would be centered upon, that player, Clarence Farmer, will not even be in double digits in carries.
Wow. Now both the coaches on the Stanford side told us how worried they were about Clarence Farmer. The coaches on the Arizona side said how important it was for Farmer to get over 100 yards. But if you don't hand the ball to the guy and make a commitment to say, hey, we're going to run this ball and we're going to try to make something happen on the ground, then he's not going to get the yards you need. And I think that's the root cause of Arizona's problems today.
Justin Faust on first down is tripped up.
Yeah, his teammates call him the freak. He's a pure athlete. He can do a standing front flip, a back flip. He can dunk a basketball. He can do a little bit of everything, but he cannot get yards unless you hand him the ball.
Faust on second down is a couple of yards short of a first down now. 71-yard run earlier for Kenneth Tolan. First career carry earlier.
Stanford's ability to just hold onto the ball and march up and down the field. I mean, it's, you know, you look at the scoreboard right now, 48 points. Some of those have come on defensive, kind of quirky defensive plays. But now this is the sixth game out of eight now that Stanford has scored 38 points or more.
Score another third down conversion for Stanford. Why Ty Willingham's club has been able to run up those big offensive numbers. They've scored 38 points a game because they've held on to the football. One of the top teams in the nation in terms of time of possession. A huge disparity in that number here tonight. And keep in mind, normally sometimes you don't see a big disparity when you have your defense scoring touchdowns. But even with the two defensive scores in the third quarter, there's still a huge gap. Here's Tolan trying to cut back, and I can assure you that time his knee was down.
You know, what Stanford is able to do is impressive with the limited number of mistakes that they make, both in terms of missed assignments, in terms of penalties. This is a team, 90 players on their roster, 50 of them are in the National